€1 million worth of catalytic converters have been seized in Dublin 11. Nearly 2,200 of them were recovered during a search operation at around 10 o'clock this morning. Over €74,000 in cash was also seized. It's part of an investigation into the theft of catalytic converters. A man in his 20s has been charged and is due to appear in court on May the 13th. Gardaí are continuing their search for a teenage girl who is missing from County Louth. 14-year-old Svetlana Murphy has not contacted her family since leaving her home in Blackrock on Monday afternoon. Gardaí say she travelled to Newry that evening with an 18-year-old man. The Irish Second Level Students' Union says gender-neutral toilets in schools are long overdue. New guidelines for the Department of Education says schools can have standalone unisex toilets with self-contained cubicles and shared sink facilities. 2 minutes past nine.
News Talk Weather.
Thanks to Ryanair, investing $20 billion in our environment with new, greener aircraft.
Friday will be another dry, bright day, but there will be more high cloud about with hazy, sunny spells. Highest temperatures of 13 to 17 degrees. Now you're up to date on News Talk.
The Football Show on Off the Ball.
With Paddy Power. Ready for your next big move? The trip from the fridge to the couch. Gamble responsibly. Gamblingcare.ie.
I'm prepared to do anything I can.
Well,
to
do it then.
Come to you again.
Do it then.
What about your start to the game?
It wasn't bad, was it?
Why should an honest answer be a mistake?
How can a modern day manager not have a mobile phone?
Why should he?
Welcome along to Thursday's football show. Nathan with you for the next hour. It is Leicester City 3, West Brom 0. Second half just getting underway at the King Power. Jamie Vardy, Johnny Evans and Kelechi Iheanacho with goals for a dominant Leicester in the first half. It could easily have been 5 or 6 and a long way back for a West Brom side that looked doomed for relegation. Leicester taking a big step towards Champions League qualification tonight. We'll have Leeds United against Manchester United live and off the ball this Sunday with Brian Kerr and Stephen Doyle. We'll be talking about Leeds United with Adam Pope a little bit later in the football show. But earlier on, I was chatting with Matt Lawson of the Times. He has been front and centre in the coverage of the failed Super League project this week. Here's how it went. So further details starting to emerge of exactly what happened around the breaking of the Super League story last weekend. Matt Lawton, chief sports writer with the Times, is with us. Evening, Matt.
Evening.
Well, there's decades where nothing happens and there's weeks where decades happen. Was that one of these for football?
It was. I have to say, Tuesday night, I was writing a splash, our back page lead. And I think I started writing it about 5 o'clock and I finished writing it at about 12:45. I wrote different versions for different editions, but I must have written about 9 different intros as the news just kept changing. From Chelsea, you know, the news broke that Chelsea were pulling out, then City confirmed they were pulling out, then Ed Woodward at Manchester United resigned. And it seemed like that would be it. And then sort of shortly before 11 o'clock, the other 4 English clubs all pulled out as well with statements. It was, I've witnessed a few nights of drama in my time, but most of them have been sport related. You know, most of them have been, like Man United in 99. You know, I was there in Barcelona. That was a sort of mental night professionally. You know, you've just rewriting everything you've just done. But that was right up there the other night.
This Super League has been talked about for decades at this stage. Were you, because of that, in any way surprised by the ferocity of the backlash? There was always going to be a reaction. There were always going to be questions from supporters. Were you surprised, considering from Sunday when this story broke to Neville and Carragher on Monday Night Football to the way it collapsed on Tuesday night? Were you taken aback in any way by just how big a story it became?
I think the moment it came out, and it was my colleague Martin Ziegler who, you know, there'd been rumblings about it. Obviously, you know, there was a story Mark Kleiman at Sky wrote last October, which was pretty much on the nail, you know, about JP Morgan. And then Martin had some great stuff in January about the exact breakdown of the Super League. And then on the Sunday lunchtime, had the detail about the clubs, English clubs signing up. I knew that there would be opposition. I'm not being smart after the event. I never thought they'd get away with it because it was so abhorrent what they were trying to do. And just the whole closed league thing and the lack of competition, I just thought there's no way anyone's going to accept that. But I guess the bit that surprised me was the fact that people who were employed by these main protagonists, these American billionaires, the managers, you know, Klopp, Guardiola, the players, Milner, it was the fact that they publicly criticised the plan. That was the bit that surprised me. You know, I was pleasantly surprised by the sort of the way there was this kind of unified response from the media, fans, government. You know, how often does that happen where everyone's on the same page? Probably never. But it was actually the fact that, you know, Klopp was, I thought his pre-match interview on Monday night was crushing for them. But then Milner piled in after the game. And then when Guardiola went for City and basically said that it's just not sport, I just thought, they're done. You've got Klopp and Guardiola against it. You know, at this moment in time, the two biggest managers in the Premier League and two members of the Big Six, you're done. This ain't happening.
Yourself and Martin Ziegler have a piece today with some of the details around of who knew what, when, and then also on the speed at which the project fell apart. It was only last Friday that senior communication staff at the six clubs were told about the Super League. And there's a brilliant quote, one of them saying, "We knew we were in for a tsunami of shit." The second they heard about this. It is incredible that a project involving billions of euro, a project that would have changed the entire face of the footballing landscape, had put such little thought into how people inside and outside of football would react to it.
Yeah, I think it is crazy because I actually think that a couple of the clubs, I think perhaps even three of the clubs, City, Chelsea and Tottenham, I don't think they knew till the end of last week how far advanced it was. And certainly, yes, you're absolutely right. On last Friday, the six sort of comms officers, the six clubs were called to this meeting. Completely, obviously, they'd seen the stories. They'd, you know, they would have been aware. I'm sure they were aware that there were talks about it and there were discussions happening. But I don't think any of them had any idea that they were actually at that point of everyone signing up for it. So they were completely taken aback. And yes, that quote, tsunami of shit. Because I think they walked out of that meeting. Or they didn't walk out because it wasn't a physical meeting. They pressed the red button on the Zoom call and were just like, oh my God. Because these guys are, you know, they're highly paid, experienced comms people, and they were thinking, right, who's it? You know, when the bomb goes off, who's actually fronting this up? You know, who is the? So it's not very well putting out that statement as they did on Sunday night with quotes from Agnelli, Perez, and Joel Glazer. It's most Joel Glazer said in however many years he's been at Man United, but. You know, who's fronting this? You know, you've got a former Downing Street spin doctor and an ex-BBC journalist who was, you know, was also involved with Project Big Picture. That one went well as well. Who's a PR guy now. And they were thinking, right, who's going to take the hits? You know, who's going to answer the questions? And the fact that there was going to be this vacuum, I think they understood that, you know, no one putting out the fires was going to be a real problem. And it did was just a wall of noise on one side that was just getting louder by the hour and nothing coming back on the other side. They were just all getting hammered. It was, you know, it was just like the artillery was flying in and there was no, they couldn't fight back.
By the sounds of it, then, there was the clash of trying to create this monster of a Super League while also maintaining secrecy, which meant that very few people knew about it. The club owners were involved. It doesn't seem as though many club executives, aside from the very, very top tier of club executives, nobody knew anything about this, which left little or no time to actually prepare a plan, a communication plan? Because you see, you look at the website, it looked like something a secondary school student put together.
Fag packet, as a colleague of mine said, back of a fag packet. Mm. Yeah, absolutely. You know, this sort of two-page thing, like the graphics looked crap, didn't they? And it was just like, what is this? You know, when it landed at about 10 to midnight on Sunday night, I was just like, really, is this it? You know, but I think the problem was, is they decided, and I think it was foolish, because I don't think it mattered. They set themselves the deadline of pulling the pin out of the grenade before UEFA were going to unveil their new plan for the Champions League. I just don't think that was necessary. But given that they were so sort of detached from what was going on anyway, why put yourself under that pressure? And it just hadn't been thought through. And yes, I think you're right. I think because they needed to maintain an element of secrecy, keep it as tight as possible. That said, somebody told me yesterday there were hundreds of people working on it in the background. You know, I assume comms people acting for, you know, as we know, but whoever was talking to JP Morgan and all the people there. So I think there were a lot of people involved, but they did keep it pretty tight. The fact they hadn't canvassed the opinion of the managers, even, you know, surely you could have had a chat with Jurgen Klopp and been pretty confident he wouldn't have blabbed it to the Merseyside reporters. You know what I mean? You could have had a chat with Pep and said, listen, Pep, you know, we're thinking about this. What do you think? And he would have said, I hate it. You know, you can't have a closed league. That's not the way it works. You know, you can't, you know, remove that incentive, remove that element of competition. You know, it'll kill the game. And then they might have thought twice about it. But I just think they saw dollar signs and so ill-conceived. It's extraordinary how, you know, I know not every rich man walking on this planet is necessarily intelligent, but I'm assuming if you're as wealthy as these guys are, they're quite bright. But they didn't show a great deal of intelligence with this one.
No. In regards to the collapse then, and success has many fathers, and it seems this success of getting it to collapse has many, from Boris Johnson trying to claim credit in the British government, royalty and Prince William's intervention seems to have been important, Richard Masters in the Premier League come out of this looking very good. Was it the political pressure, or was it that sheer footballing presence of Klopp before the match? As you say, Guardiola's strong comments, and in particular James Milner, that felt like a big moment when he said, I don't like it and I don't want it. It was straight up to his owners, this ain't happening.
And then that fake Twitter account, Boring James Milner, they need to reconsider that, don't they? Because it was a pretty important intervention from James Milner, and he deserves all our respect for that. But I think it was a combination. I do know that they were stunned by, you know, look, let's not be naive. It was a good PR opportunity to intervene in this respect. You know, there were obviously a couple of smart Downing Street spin doctors that thought we should get involved in this. But no, I think they were stunned that by the sheer speed with which the Prime Minister was engaged and the tone of what he was saying. When he talked about dropping a legislative bomb on them, it's pretty strong stuff. You know, we knew that they were going to look at law changes. We knew they were going to look at, they were going to throw every obstacle in the way if it hadn't collapsed as soon as it had. They would have looked at the sort of work permit area. You know, I don't know they would have done this, but they could have gone as far, because every game that is played has to be sanctioned by the FA. And it's on that basis that work permits are given, particularly post-Brexit. They could have literally, to the clubs that have stepped out of that pyramid, they could have literally sent the managers, the foreign managers and the foreign players packing from those clubs. They could have done that. And another move they could have made, I was told, and I discussed this with someone within sort of government circles, was they could have made it a listed event. And this would have been fairly straightforward, I was told. And what that means, a listed event, is they could have made it like the World Cup and the Olympics. And when you do that with a listed event, it means that only the terrestrial broadcasters can bid for it.
So the value of the rights goes way down.
For the World Cup. Mm. Oh my God, absolutely. JP Morgan would have run for the hills because it would have been, hang on a minute, how are we going to get our $4 billion back? So absolutely, there was, and I think those kind of noises, it was getting through. And at the same time, I think what was really interesting was that, as we've said, it was at the very highest level. It was at ownership level that these conversations were happening in most cases. And what you did have going on in the background was you had CEOs and people at that level having conversations with other CEOs at other clubs, at the FA, at the Premier League, at UEFA, saying, this is a disaster. So it was really interesting that the FA, UEFA, Premier League, they knew on Tuesday morning that they were wobbling. I think they knew on Monday night they were wobbling. Now, how do they know that? They know that because they've got sources within those six clubs. You know? So we knew. I got a call at 9:30 on Tuesday morning saying Chelsea and Man City were wobbling.
Right.
And we ran a story at lunchtime. We have set editions. We have 9, midday, 5, and then at midnight. And so our midday edition, we ran a story to that effect that clubs were wobbling. And of course, by tea time, as Jamie Carragher said on Monday Night Football on Sky, it would only take one to go. Now, by that point, there'd been a meeting all afternoon. The 12 rebel clubs had been meeting all afternoon. And I think Chelsea just decided they had fans demonstrating outside the ground. They had a match on and they decided, you know, I think Abramovich just gave the order, do it now, get us out. And that's what they did.
Chelsea and Manchester City were among the last clubs to agree to this. And it seems by Friday ended up being sort of railroaded in that this is happening this weekend. You've got to come in now or you're going to miss the boat. What were their misgivings? Because we are talking about two clubs who have changed the face of English football over the past 15, 16 years with their ownership structure, with their buying power. It can't have been sporting integrity that they needed relegation, that they felt that this was the best thing for the sport. Why was it that the owners of those two clubs weren't that keen to get involved?
No, I think it would have been that. I honestly think it would have been that. It would have been, their reservations would have been the reservations that were expressed by Pep Guardiola. And I just think they would have, I think they were bright enough to see that it wasn't going to be popular. That they would be seen as pariahs. You know, the fact of the matter is, we go back to that Friday meeting with the comms officers. You know, the media strategy was, as we said in the piece today, it's going to be a bumpy ride. We just got to stick together. Well, it was a bit of an understatement. But I think they knew that. I think they realised that. But you suddenly get, you know, one source at a club put it to me, they were faced with that dilemma because they were being told, if you don't jump on the train now, it won't be stopping again. Now, I'm not sure how true that was, because I think Bayern Munich, I'm quite sure, if they'd put their hand up, the train would have stopped for them.
Yeah.
You know, because I think that was a big problem for them right from the start. Again, you know, as I'm not trying to be wise after the event, but I always thought, how can this work when the reigning European champions are saying we don't want any part of this? You know, never mind Paris Saint-Germain. It was a massive problem. I say, when you've got a club of the stature of Bayern Munich saying, no, we're not doing it, how can it be a Super League if they're not in it? So it was just fraught with problems and an incredible episode.
There's obviously been a huge amount of anger over the last few days towards the six clubs and what recriminations there should be for the clubs now from the 14 other Premier League teams, and should there be points deductions or potentially transfer bans. It doesn't sound as though any of that is likely. Is it a case that the biggest loss for the six clubs is that their bargaining tool that they've held over everybody for years upon years upon years, that we can go, we can go. That's gone. That's gone forever. It's hard to see, despite Florentino Perez appearing on late night radio in Spain, that that bargaining tool that they had is now gone forever.
Yeah, I certainly think they will struggle to act as the, certainly in the Premier League, as the Big Six. And you've got to think that that Big Six thing has been, I think it contributed to Richard Scudamore leaving the Premier League. I think it contributed to Susanna Dinage not taking the job.
Why? Because they just wouldn't have the power that they would want as CEO?
Just because there was this group that held such power and were just going to be a problem. And I think it certainly has. It will make it much harder for them to. Well, they just won't be able to do it. You know, we've done a story tonight. Martin's written it. That they are looking to change the laws, but also the rules in this country to make sure that never happens again. That you can't do that if you're part of the Premier League. You can't get involved in a breakaway league that. That basically destroys the pyramid of European football. You know, look, in that meeting of the 14 excluded clubs on Tuesday, there was a real desire for retribution. You know, I spoke to one of the CEOs that was in the meeting, and there were calls for the Ed Woodwards, the Daniel Levy's, to be individually sanctioned for charged with bringing the game into disrepute. You know, possibly suspended from football. There was that kind of talk going on among the clubs. They were that angry. They felt that betrayed. But once they crumbled, I think there's a realization that at the end of the day, the Premier League needs to be those 20 clubs, and they need those six clubs in there. Look, they're going to be removed from the subcommittees. You know, we had the story this morning that they're going to be removed from the subcommittees. They're not going to have the same power. You know, the days of Bruce Buck sort of driving, you know, the Chelsea chairman driving the campaign for Richard Scudamore to get his £5 million golden farewell. He ain't going to be in that role anymore. They're going to have to, as one comms guy put it to me, they're going to be sat on the naughty step for a while. But the main thing now is prevention. It is the main focus is making sure that this doesn't happen again.
Florentino Perez said last night in that interview that the Super League is on standby, despite 9 of the 12 clubs withdrawing. We're going to continue working. This project is on standby. Is this Florentino Perez in full-on comical alley mode? Or even with the changes that UEFA are proposing that aren't a million miles away in some ways from a Super League, but is there a possibility that some form of a Super League, even more changes to the Champions League, come about because of this?
Well, that's the point. I think he's in denial, and I think he's trying to save face because it's been humiliating for him, to say the least. I think what this means, the sentiment to some degree of what they're getting at is right. What these clubs are getting at in terms of getting a greater say in basically getting a greater share of the pie. You know, UEFA, FIFA, questioning their power and how much of the money stays with them, you know, when they are the stars of the show. But I think the difference will be that when that happens, it will be as a collective, not as an elite. So when that happens, when that pressure is applied to try and get a better deal for themselves at UEFA or whoever, when it comes to those kind of negotiations, they will have to act with the knowledge of everybody for the benefit of everybody. And that's the difference. So what you won't have are these secret squirrel meetings and conversations. It really was. I think Steve Parish was on the telly, and he was just basically saying these guys were lying to them in meetings, in Premier League meetings, when they're talking about broadcasting and they're talking about Project Big Picture and they're talking about the Super League. They're denying it. They were making a commitment only last week. It's what Seferin said about snakes and lions. They're basically saying, we're in full support of the Champions League reforms. And then 2 days later, they drop the bomb. So So that's the thing. It will hopefully, you know, I can't speak for what will happen in Spain and Italy, but I'm pretty confident that the English clubs certainly know now that that kind of behaviour will not be tolerated. And I'll be amazed if they dare try and do that again. And at the same time, as I've said, there are going to be changes made to sort of things like competition law in this country, to the rules, to the rule book with the FA, rule book with the Premier League, to make sure they just can't do it. If you want to be part of the Premier League, if you want to be involved in English football, if you want to be part of this great sort of tradition, this great history, then you got to play by these rules. So, I don't see this happening again. It won't be the bombshell moment.
Yeah.
That we've just experienced over the last few days.
And what about the owners then, the Glazers, FSG, Stan Kroenke? Because at the height of this on Monday and Tuesday, there were a lot of influential voices, Jamie Carragher, who were very strong around the American ownership, that they had to sell up, that there was no way back, there was no way of mending the bridges that had been broken with the supporters. Is it realistic to think any of them would sell up because of this?
Well, the first thing you've got to do is find a buyer.
Mm.
So you know, that's a bit of a challenge, particularly in this year of the pandemic.
And I know, listen, we'd all like the perfect world of a 50+1 scheme where the clubs are some way handed back to the supporters. That doesn't seem in this current climate in any way is a possibility. So are there good owners out there?
Look, I have to say, I think the Americans at Liverpool have been good owners. Until this, I think they've been great owners.
Have they not got a lot wrong? Is there not a consistent level of apology, whether it was the furloughing of staff?
Oh, no. They've damaged their, you know, John Henry has damaged his reputation in the eyes of the fans, absolutely no doubt. But when you look at the Americans at Liverpool and the Americans at United, I think the Americans at Liverpool have got far more credit in the bank, far more credit, you know. The way they've redeveloped Anfield, new training ground, they appointed Jurgen Klopp. They've won the league. You know, they've ended that drought. They've won the European Cup again. I think they had a lot of credit in the bank. I don't think anyone was particularly unhappy with them until now. And so I think they can recover. I might be wrong. I don't live far from Liverpool, but I wouldn't try and read the minds of the Liverpool fans, but I think it's different for the Glazers. I think it'd be very difficult when fans are back for the Glazers to sit there in that ground. I think they've had an absolute disaster. But I think, as I say, I think the Liverpool owners can get past this. I might be wrong. Jamie Carragher might tell me I'm talking out my backside.
Yeah, good luck to Ed Woodward's replacement, I think. It's going to be quite a gig. Matt, yes. Great work over the last week. Fair play. Thanks for joining us.
Cheers. Thanks a lot.
Football on Off the Ball.
With Paddy Power. Ready for your next big move? The trip from the fridge to the couch. Gamble responsibly. Gamblingcare.ie.
Show Me the Science with Professor Luke O'Neill.
A Newstalk original podcast series focusing on different issues, from the serious to the silly. All explained through science. Catch up on the podcast series at newstalk.com or on the Newstalk app.
Audi Ireland's dealer network is here to help you choose your new Audi. Browse our range of petrol, diesel, hybrid and fully electric vehicles online. The health and safety of staff and customers remains our priority. We have social distancing measures and personalised solutions in place to help you experience and safely choose the right Audi for you. Contact your local authorised Audi dealer today to arrange an appointment. Future is an attitude. Future is an Audi.
Today, you can alleviate stress on your company finances and stress on the electricity grid by participating in demand response with NLX. By adjusting your energy usage for just a few hours per year, your business could receive a welcome revenue boost, and we could all benefit from a more sustainable future. With NLX, the power really is in your hands. To find out more, visit demandresponse.ie.
We can't predict the Irish weather. At Experts Electrical with the George Foreman Indoor-Outdoor Barbecue Grill, why bother? Sun shines? Cook for the gang outside. Rain? Brighten the day with a barbecue inside. Non-stick, easy clean and just €99. Get the George Foreman Indoor-Outdoor Barbecue Grill at Experts Electrical stores nationwide and expert.ie.
Describe Maynooth University in three words.
You're in control.
Young, bold, progressive.
Skills for life.
Gives you choice.
Feel so happy.
Choose the university that puts you first.
Best decision ever.
Online Spring Open Day, April 24th. Visit openday.maynoothuniversity.ie. Maynooth University, know no bounds.
When you find the right home, you want nothing to get in your way. That's why Leia Life offer mortgage protection in minutes, not weeks. Our fast, straightforward mortgage protection application process is the best way to keep your mortgage moving. No paperwork or medical, just a few simple questions and you're covered in an instant, starting at €2.33 per week. For mortgage protection that's streets ahead, visit leialife.ie or call 1890 907 100.
Insurance provided by IPTQ Life SA. Leia Healthcare Limited, trading as Leia Life and Leia Healthcare, is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland.
Football on Off the Ball.
With Paddy Power. Ready for your next big move? The trip from the fridge to the couch. Gamble responsibly. Gamblingcare.ie.
Welcome back. It's Thursday's football show and Off the Ball. Still Leicester City 3, West Brom 0. First half goals from Jamie Vardy. Johnny Evans and Kelechi Iheanacho of Leicester in total control at the King Power. 15 minutes left will move Leicester 4 points clear of West Ham in fifth and will leave West Brom 9 points from safety. Some really good stuff from Matt Lawton there on the Super League. We've had loads of brilliant coverage all week long on OTB AM and PM. If you missed any of it, just get onto the OTB Sports app right now. You can get all the podcasts there. You can subscribe to our football podcasts so you'll get them as they happen. Now, our live game this Sunday on Off the Ball, Elland Road, Leeds United against Manchester United. One of those days where you would just love for it to be a packed house. But Brian Kerr and Stephen Doyle are going to be along for that one from 2 o'clock. To talk about Leeds, I'm delighted to be joined by the BBC's Adam Pope. Evening, Adam.
Evening, Nathan.
It is one of those days where you would absolutely love Elland Road packed to the rafters, United in town. Whew, tasty.
Oh, it's the biggest one, isn't it? It's the one everybody looked at. They are ancient rivals for anybody that knows the football, Nathan, you know. And I know Johnny Giles would have spoken about it, but this is one of the big rivalries in English football. And I know they haven't had the chance to clash that much, but yeah, in normal circumstances, this is venomous, an absolute bear pit of a game. And on the back of Liverpool, which would have been pretty tasty as well with the crowd in, it would have been like the ultimate week for Leeds fans, really, I think, this week.
Is the Leeds-Manchester United rivalry like the Ireland-England rivalry, where we really don't like the English and want to beat them all the time and it means absolutely everything, and the English kind of look at Ireland and go, yeah, whatever, it's not really happening for us? Is this far bigger for Leeds than it is for Manchester United?
I think Manchester United fans would say that, but wasn't it funny that even in the time that Leeds had in League One, never mind, you know, just in the Championship, Manchester United still sang about Leeds. And it's still venomous. When they went there and won as a League One side in the FA Cup in one of the most memorable, you know, upsets back in 2010, you knew it meant something. And it is. I'm not being funny. It's vicious, and it does go both ways. There's no doubt about it. I mean, obviously, Manchester United and Liverpool over the years, they're having obviously a cross rivalry with City and the noisy neighbours. But this one's got something very, very special about it, and it takes anybody that follows football through the 60s, 70s and 80s will know exactly what I mean.
Leeds have been a joy to watch this season. They brought so much to the Premier League and will be hoping to kick on over the next couple of years and maybe get themselves back to where they were 20 years ago into the Champions League. They would have been one of the potential big victims of the Super League. They were one of the first to take a stand. They wore the T-shirts on Monday night ahead of the game against Liverpool. How did that come about? Was that player-driven? Was that driven by the Premier League?
Well, that's really interesting, that, because we know that Patrick Bamford came out after the game and said what he said and about the coverage that the ESL has had, and that he didn't think it was a good idea. And then he also mentioned things like, you know, racism as well should be covered just as much, which is a problem in the game. Today, I spoke to Pascal Strauch about it too, and he reiterated it, and he said all the players felt the same way. I think it was club-driven, largely, because Andrea Radrizzani, the chairman and majority shareholder, he was very open on in Italian on his Twitter feed, having a go at the team, or the club that he purports to support as a young lad, Juventus, who obviously were one of the instigators of this, too, under Agnelli. So that was very much a club stance on it too. I can see why as well, Nathan, because if you look at someone like Leeds, who are now committing themselves to a big ground redevelopment, and then you look at a club like, say, Everton, who are right in the midst of a ground move, £550 million worth, clubs like that, who, as you say, have got an historical success, they could be classed as, you know, one of the very big clubs, if you go back on whatever criteria you want to choose. I think they're the sorts of clubs right now who are trying to do it in the so-called right way that really stood to be disadvantaged by this. And you could end up with literally sort of white elephants of football grounds that have been redeveloped to help progress the club and the community as well, I should say, but have been left stranded by the snakes of the six that were, you know, in this country alone, we're going to move away and set up their own European league.
And we shouldn't forget about all those multi-millionaire and billionaire owners who weren't in the top six, who suddenly, having had so much success in their life and getting so much of what they wanted, found themselves as the paupers in this, were left behind. And Andrea Radrizzani, the Leeds owner, is a wealthy man. He's a man who has been very involved in the more new, the more modern side of the rights deals. He was the head of 11 Sports. He's been to the forefront of the modernisation of television viewing. What was his personal reaction, do you suspect, to the fact that people he would like to see he's probably at a level with in some ways have sort of moved past and were more than willing to leave him behind?
Yeah, he wasn't happy about it, you know, and I think on sporting merit, he found it very, very difficult to swallow, didn't enjoy it at all. Now, I think it's interesting that you raise that point because of the interest that he has, because look at somebody like PSG, of course, who notably weren't involved in this as such, although the invite was there. You know, Nasser Khalifa, who's a big friend of Radrizzani, for example, he's involved in TV with BN Sport, who are heavily embedded into the Champions League. So someone like him thought, well, do I stick with what I've got, I suppose, or do I go to this new venture and basically end up suing himself, I suppose, if he got out of the deal with the existing Champions League with Sky, be in sports and go somewhere else. So it is interesting when you've got big people at the top of these football clubs who are involved in sports rights and in broadcasting. Now, Radrizzani was clear that he's not going for this, didn't like it at all. It's interesting with Leeds, though, Nathan, because they've got a 37.5% owned by an American. It's San Francisco 49ers Enterprises. And it'd be interesting to see if they were to eventually become majority shareholders, how would they sit alongside Henry's and Glazers and what have you? Now, to my mind, they're very much aligned with Radrizzani and therefore were against this idea. And I do know for a fact that they were very much, I didn't say the instigator, but they were behind the messages of Football for the Fans in terms of the banners that were inside and outside Elland Road on Monday night against Liverpool. So they do seem to, at this stage, certainly have got the culture of what sport is in these aisles and how different it is to America. So I do think it's genuine, the opposition to what was going ahead, although obviously people will have reservations because of the type of business that these people are involved in.
Looking at the financial side of it then from Leeds as we head towards a transfer window, maybe all of this is linked up with Marcelo Bielsa and we should talk about him first, but if they spent money last summer, not huge money, but they bought a couple of centre-backs in Llorente and Coque. They've probably been unfortunate with injury with the two centre-halves. A lot of people are questioning them defensively, but maybe if they were there all season, it'd be different. Rodrigo's had injury problems throughout the season and Rafinha, the one who's played all the time, has been exceptional. But you're talking still, what, 70, 80 million for those four players? Are they in a position, if Bielsa signs a new contract, to go and invest heavily and really try and kick on from that sort of 10th, 11th position where they're going to finish and push for a European spot next season?
Well, I think invest, yes. How heavy, that's a bit subjective. If you remember also last summer, they put Helder Costa onto the transfer bill, if on that side of the accounts, if you like, they ended up paying fully for him, which was, I believe, 17 plus another four. So it was about 100 million all in with those signings. I think they'll go again with three or four. Now, Premier League level, that's probably going to be a similar amount of money. So I think they're in a position to do it, despite the account sharing a loss of 60-odd million for up till July, for the 30 months up to the end of July last year. I think they're in a really good position because they don't have, Nathan, they don't have, you know, huge amounts of players to move off their books that are bringing them down on heavy wages and stuff like that. So I think the scope, left back, I do think they need another keeper as well. I know they want another midfielder because the deal for Cuisance fell down, as you recall, earlier in the season. So there's three areas straight away. And they're going to have to get another striker, I think, at some point. However, I think you're going to see the best of those existing signings that you talked about. Rodrigo, who is a brilliant player, but he's been hampered with injury. Llorente's done 8 games on the bounce now. He looks sensational, Nathan, at the moment. He got his first goal. Robin Koch had his injury problems, so he's come back and is playing a bit part at the moment, but both those players, they look absolute snips. And then the ultimate snip, you mentioned Rafinha, who sadly missed the Liverpool game through injury. Hope he'll be all right for Sunday with that thigh problem. I mean, he must have trebled his value already by now. But I think they're in a good place to go and do something similar again this summer.
Is Bielsa almost a victim of his own success then when they're going into the transfer market? Because you look at what he's done with players who we thought were of a certain level, but he has brought them to a whole other level, whether it's the likes of Luke Ayling at right back, who has been talked about in an England squad and would certainly be in the mix if we're talking about a team of the season at right back. Stuart Dallas, who I don't want to say has been a journeyman, but is having the most sensational season in a variety of different positions for Leeds, that actually the owners might be looking, thinking, we don't need to spend 40 million. If we spend 20 million, we know we've got a manager who's actually going to get the very best out of that player.
I totally agree with you. And I think Stuart Dallas is a great example too. You know, this is also where the ESL would have really killed these sort of dreams. You know, we spoke to the Crusaders goalkeeper the other day, Sean O'Neill, and he talked about Stuart Dallas saying, look, we knew he'd be great. Didn't think he'd light up the Premier League the way he has done. But as you say, he went through the whole pyramid system, didn't he? Brentford, he went out on loan to Northampton, went to Leeds. Wasn't great at Leeds at the beginning. 6-7 out of 10, maybe. Weren't quite sure where it was going to work. 9 out of 10 playing midfield now and fullback, wherever you put them, fantastic. They will find value in players around Europe as well. Look what they've done, like with Melier, just a few million. And I think this is the great, there's so much stock now in what Victor Orta, the director of football, is doing in terms of, you know, the transfer planning, the scouting for players, that they're really starting to turn, you know, polishing up players that use raw material very quickly into solid Premier League players or even better. And his network is excellent. So I think they'll find value in what will be a deflated market probably elsewhere in Europe as well. So I think you're right. They won't overspend and it will only be a few players because we know he likes a very tight squad, don't we? I mean, he doesn't really work with more than 22, if you like, first team players and a sprinkling of youngsters in there as well.
The players who could leave the club then potentially if the money came in, Rafinha is one who's, as you say, probably trebled in value and has consistently been linked with Liverpool even over the past few months. Calvin Phillips is going to go to the European Championship. If he has a good tournament, the world is really his oyster, particularly that type of midfielder. It doesn't feel like there's a huge amount of them around at the moment. Are they the main two? Like, is Bamford somebody you look at and think he's most definitely going to be at Leeds next season, or is the potential after the goals he scored and the performance he's put in that could go?
I'm not massively worried about losing one of their, you know, so-called top players, if you like. I think Rafinha will start. I think they'll at least get another season, or certainly till the next, you know, window after the summer out of him. I genuinely do believe that because I don't think that they have to sell. Although, obviously, if there's ludicrous prices going around, then maybe. So I'm not particularly concerned there either. I think the bond that they forged over the last 3 years, some of those players, anyway, I know not Rafinha so much, but I think there's a real willingness to see this through and that they can go on and achieve something really special together. And hopefully if Europe is left open as a window, then that will be maybe a year or two away. I think some of these players wouldn't be able to do it elsewhere. It's because of Bielsa, as you say, it's because of the system, it's because of the way he makes them work. And I don't think they'd be as effective elsewhere. What I do think, there will be some players, sadly, and probably even though he's got another year, Hernandez, you know, you do wonder about Alioski. He's out of contract and nothing's been sorted yet to keep him at the club, or, you know, there's talk about him going off to Turkey as well, which is not being met with great reception because it's Galatasaray and we know there's some horrible history between the clubs. So, and the support, obviously. So, and I think you'll probably see some of those, I wouldn't necessarily say fringe players, but players that they might look to replace now. And that's sad because they won't get the send-off that they need. But the top players, if you like, the big performers this season, I think they'll keep hold of Nathan.
Yeah, and they do now have important players, but nobody is more important there than the manager right now, Marcelo Bielsa. And you mentioned John Giles has been raving about him again this evening as to how much he enjoys watching Leeds and how much admires the fact that he does the same thing in every game, how direct Leeds are all the time. That even that night against Manchester United the last time when Leeds got well beaten straight after they had a stunning win against Newcastle, they have this defeat against Manchester United, and you know, it could have been a 10-5 that day. Like, John was making the point, you can't play that way as a one-off and suddenly become defensive against Manchester United. They've got to stick with the rhythm and the routine of every single game. That's just not him. He was saying if Manchester United had any sense, they get rid of Ole Gunnar Solskjaer and bring in Bielsa. That Jose Mourinho's gone at Spurs, they should go after Bielsa. I know, because of his personality, maybe those clubs aren't going to go there, but his contract is always the big talking point around Leeds. Where are they heading into the summer?
Yeah, there was an erroneous report recently in La Nación in Argentina that suggested he was close to signing a two-year deal, and he basically said to me, no, he said that report is wrong. You know, there is, I have no store by that. It is inaccurate. So what he said a few months ago now, when Radrizzani came out and said, look, we have to think of a succession plan, you know, ideally he stays, but, you know, we have to think going forward, blah, blah, blah. So Bielsa likes to do this stuff at the end of a season, as we know. But he did say, look, if they force me to, then I will give them an answer before the end of the season. And basically said, all the conditions here are great. You know, it's an absolute privilege to work here. I love here. I love what's going on. Everything's in place. So there's no flies in the ointment there, other than he just likes to sort out in his own time. So I personally think he'll stay and sign another year, which is what he does, because everything seems to be aligned. However, I don't think the pen's anywhere near the paper at the moment, but in his mind, that won't be a problem. Don't forget, Nathan, they started the season against Liverpool and nothing had been officially announced that he'd sign up for the season at that point. So I'm not overly concerned. We've sort of got used to how he works. Ideally for the club planning, you'd like to. But it's not because he's been obstinate, I don't think, Nathan. It's because he said, look, when I've been asked about this with 10 games to go, what happens if we fall off a cliff in terms of results? Will they think differently about me then? Why don't we all wait and assess the season as a whole? And that's why, and Johnny's right saying that, that's why they will keep playing this way until the end of the season, regardless of the fact they're safe, because he demands the highest levels from every game. So until Sam Allardyce and probably an already relegated West Brom come on the final day, this lot will be going hell for leather, and then he will want to assess where he's at going forward.
The fall off a cliff was a criticism from a couple of years ago when it was felt they just ran out of steam, that he had worked them too hard, and that over the final quarter of the season they just had nothing left in the tank. A sense that maybe they benefited from the COVID break last year, which meant that when they came back they were ready to go once again. Like, there's been no sign of that at all this year. I heard Patrick Bamford in the post-match interview saying, yeah, we're tired, but everybody's tired. Every player and every team is tired. It doesn't seem that hard-running style, that breakaway in the 90th minute where they're still pushing for a third or fourth goal and 5-6 players make this lung-busting 60, 70-yard run, they're still able to do that.
Nathan, it's never been an issue. It really is. It's the biggest sort of misnomer, inaccurate thing about his time, certainly at Leeds. They were running... So even the best example for me, the Derby game, which was effectively, they were already crowned champions at the end of last season, basically walked out there as champions. They ran more that day, and I know it was a vastly changed side, and a few of them had hangovers, I think, but they ran more that day than they had done all season. So it doesn't matter. It's just so untrue to say that this side runs out of steam. They don't. It's a different thing losing your bottle against Derby in the second leg the year before. That's a completely different thing. But never running out of steam. No, they are. I was chatting to Pascal Strout today, and they've done this infamous murder ball session that you'll have heard of for half an hour. 11, absolutely full on. No throw-ins, no corners, no nothing. It's just full on. In the sunshine, thankfully, at last two. And he said, look, it's always hard, but there's a smile on his face. And I know because they're winning and they're doing well at the moment, but it's never changed. So they're used to it now, and it's... They will go until the final minute of the final game against West Brom, and who knows what's going to happen by then in terms of the table, because they've already this month got four more points than I was expecting, you know, yeah. with the one Liverpool and Man City, and who knows on Sunday, you know, you're not going to rule out them taking something on Manchester United.
And players never complain when results are going well and things are going right, as they have at Leeds. Have you ever heard any murmurs of discontent from the intensity of those training sessions, of what he expects from his players?
Do you know what? I'll be genuine with you, and you would have heard over 3 years, no. I think anybody that couldn't hack it is gone.
Right.
And I remember particularly Samu Saiz, if you remember him, who was infamous for the spitting incident prior to Bielsa at Newport, and lovely, talented player. He saw in pre-season, he was nowhere near the others. He was literally football pitches behind the others in the general warm-up. And I thought, yeah, you're going to struggle. And I think, but genuinely, you don't hear discontent. I think the one thing they found really hard, some of the players, and Janssen mentioned this before we went to Brentford, is that those players that need a very close relationship with their head coach or their manager, he doesn't get it. He takes that distance, as we know. Mm. He's not particularly hands-on in that sense. But then again, you see other moments, don't you? When he goes and hugs Patrick Bamford, when he volleyed in that thing that went viral, you know, when he was up in training, he hit that volley over the top of the keeper, yeah, when he was coming from injury a couple of years ago, and you see him running across, you know, the training ground to hug him. So he has those moments. You saw the video when they got promoted, when they're all celebrating. You know, he's got a really lovely touch on them as well. But, you know, I mean, funny enough, I was talking about the communication method, even though he still speaks Spanish. He uses his coach's staff to speak in English. And I said to Pascal Strout today, I said, it's still weird to us how he gets his message across. Is it at all difficult? He says, no, it's very, very simple. It makes it very easy. Videos and through his coaches, we understand exactly what we need to do in possession and when not in possession too. And he gives us a license to do, you know, to express ourselves too. But his communication is fantastic. So I don't know anybody that is struggling with the setup there at all.
Adam, great stuff as always. Good to talk to you.
You too, Nathan.
Leeds against Manchester United live here and off the ball on Sunday. Leicester have eased to a 3-0 win against West Brom. We'll take a quick break.
Football on Off the Ball.
With Paddy Power. Fake crowd noise? The Emirates never sounded so good. Gamble responsibly. Gamblingcare.ie.
Born from our expertise in Formula One, Renault E-Tech technology now features in our range of everyday hybrid and electric cars. Discover the number one selling electric vehicle range in Ireland with finance from 0% APR, €1,000 green bonus and 3 months deferred payments. See why we are the number one electric vehicle manufacturer in Ireland. Visit your local Renault dealer today. Offers made under a hire purchase agreement. Deposit required, subject to lending criteria. Terms and conditions apply. See Renault.ie.
Spring clean your home with Samsung cordless jet vacuums at Harvey Norman. Save €50 on the Samsung Jet 70 Turbo Cordless Vacuum, now $399. There's plenty of power to vacuum the whole house in one go with up to 40 minutes runtime. It's all down to the long-lasting removable battery. And the Samsung Jet 70 Turbo Cordless Vacuum will banish even the tiniest dust particles from carpets and hard floors. Shop the full range of Samsung Jet Cordless Vacuums online at harveynorman.ie or safely in store. Go!
My, what white walls your rental has. Wouldn't it be a shame if someone drew all over them for no reason? And what do we have here? You're back living in your childhood bedroom, and all that 90s sci-fi memorabilia is starting to feel like a bit of a mood kill. Ready to move, but don't know where to start? Start here with EBS, the Mortgage Masters. Lending criteria, terms and conditions apply. EBS DAC is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland.
Sunrise. A moment of warmth. A time of hope. While we can't gather for darkness into light in the way we usually do, we can all share one sunrise together. The same sunrise that gives hope to those impacted by suicide each year. The same sunrise that helps Pieta raise vital funds to continue their life-saving work. So please join Pieta and Electric Ireland for a special Darkness into Light sunrise on May 8th. Because under one sunrise, we're brighter together. Sign up now at darknessintolight.ie. Proudly supported by Electric Ireland.
Football on Off the Ball.
With Paddy Power. Ready for your next big move? The trip from the fridge to the couch. Gamble responsibly. Gamblingcare.ie.
All right, that's pretty much us done for this evening. If you missed any of the football show, we had Adam Pope there chatting about Leeds. We had Matt Lawton on the Super League and John Giles earlier. That's all on the OTB Sports app. Really good stuff from Noelle Healy as well after her retirement following a massively successful career with Dublin. You can get all of that on the OTB Podcast Network. We're back with OTB AM from 7:30 tomorrow morning. Ronan O'Gara, he will not, I'm assured, be in a bath full of cash, but he has his new 3-year deal at La Rochelle. He's going to be talking about that tomorrow morning with Adrian Anone, Alan Quinlan as well, Lauro on the football and a crappy quiz. And then we're back in the radio tomorrow night from 7. Former Munster and Ireland player Rosie Foley will be chatting about her own career and her late brother Anthony Axel Foley. Maxine O'Sullivan will be on Friday Night Racing. She won the Amateur Gold Cup at Cheltenham. So lots to look forward to over the next little while. And Off the Ball, we'll talk to you soon. Good luck.
Out of grass, he'll give you a move for the perfect pass. Give him a ball and he out of space, he'll give you a move with good league race. Ra-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta.